Hi Hansel sir, welcome to the Red Sparrow. How are you sir?
Very good, thank you, Shashi.
Thank you for giving us the time sir. Welcome to our show Untangled. So today we'll be untangling many of the bits and pieces that make up Hansel Mehta, both the artist and the person behind the artist. I've been reading your interviews, and in an interview you said that you were reading George Orwell's 1984 in the beginning of the lockdown. And also on your Instagram, you've been posting about many movies, frames of movies. Could you recommend some books and movies to us that you have come across in this lockdown? Some rare gems that people should watch and read?
You got me there. I mean, I don't know about rare gems. I'm not, you know, I must admit one thing. I'm not a crazy film buff. Okay, I love making movies, and I watch movies. I mean, I really enjoy watching films, but I'm not Anurag Kashyap,
You don't have the DVD library in your house?
Well, I have a library of cookbooks, so if you ask me for recommendations for cookbooks, I can give you more. You know, unlike Anurag, who really devours films, you know, the way I devour, the way I eat, way I can drink tea, Anurag watches movies. I mean, he has. So I'm not that kind. I don't have that kind of an appetite for watching films. I mean, George Orwell's 1984 was something I began. The lockdown has been a slightly crazy period because, you know, we have been. It started off on this note that, you know, I'm going to be reading a lot of books, watching, catching
Yes.
up on so many films. But then, you know, when reality strikes, you realize there's also work to do. You need to do the dishes, you need to cook 3 meals. You also had I had a project that I needed to complete, two projects in fact, my film Chalang and my show based on the Harshad Mehta scam. So there was a lot of work to be completed. So currently based on my current state of mind, my immediate recommendation is that, you know, watch my show when it is out.
Surely, surely, we'll do that for sure.
So yeah, I started, I mean, 1984, I sort of revisited because, you know, we entered this lockdown, and through the lockdown, I mean, before the lockdown also, there was this state of despair. And it was just a very unconscious choice. It was there on Audible. So I started off by, you know, using it as something I was listening to while on my morning walks. And then I decided to read it. You know, I'm not sure whether I was happy reading it because it was
Okay.
it's a very, very grim reminder of our times. And
True, true.
1984 is happening in 2020, and it's happening in India. We are living in Oceania.
You have also been doing a lot of other things. Like, I've seen a post of yours on Instagram where you are reading out stories to small kids. Can you tell us some other things you have explored other than reading and consuming movies, which are not related to filmmaking directly?
Consuming more shows than movies, yes. And I mean, this reading stories to the kids was something my wife, you know, works with girls, with a girl child. She works in girls' education, and then she runs a fairly large non-profit that works for the girl child. So, as part of her lockdown program, she was experimenting with a model to, you know, allow marginalized kids to sort of, you know, continue their education without having to rely on online resources. You know, they don't, these are the kids at the lowest rung of the economic ladder. And it's an attempt, and it's an attempt, I mean, it's a codified attempt to try and, you know, sort of keep them abreast with their education and not deprive them of the education or not, and to ensure that there's no break in their education. So this was a small hamlet near the village I was staying, where there were a lot of these kids from marginalized homes whose parents could not even afford a mobile phone. You know, a regular dabba phone they could not afford. So we have been running classes there. And my wife does not, you know, speak Marathi. So I was the resident Marathi expert. So I was reading all these Marathi stories. And I enjoy Marathi as a language. And you know, reading out in Marathi sort of helped me myself polish my Marathi.
How wonderful.
It's great. I mean, to see children, you know, that's like, you know, like when you make a film, when you perform in theater, when you make a film, when you show it to an audience at a film festival. Similarly, you know, reading a story to children is like that. Mm-hmm. You know, you have audience and their response sort of propels you to tell more stories.
Yeah, it's very organic. You feel the energy, I guess. So, sir, now we will enter into the format of the show. So we divide the conversation into three sections.
Yeah.
The first one is called Inception. So there we will talk about your childhood in Bombay and your engineering days, your work in Australia, coming back to Mumbai. And then we will go into the second section called Assembly Line. Since you call yourself an accidental filmmaker, you say you didn't train. So we will talk about the learnings and trainings you had while being in the process on television and your early films which you made. Then we'll go into the third section called Harvest, where we will talk about what you call as your second innings, Hansal Mehta 2.0, which you talk about. And we'll talk about the work that we see today, we love today. So let's begin with Inception. So you say that you were born in Bombay, but today you live in Mumbai. And your family has been in the city for many years. How was your childhood like in Bombay? What did you want to be? What was your family into? And what was the impact of films in your childhood?
I grew up in a normal Gujarati family. I was the first born, you know, the only child of my grandparents. So I was like thoroughly spoiled when I was a kid by my grandparents. And so I was the first grandchild, like both my mother's side, from the maternal and the paternal side. So I was like spoiled silly as a child. We were a normal Gujarati family, and I grew up going to school in the in what is no longer the suburbs of Mumbai. It's almost South Mumbai, the Bandra Khar area. So I grew up there, I grew up when I was very small. I mean, my grandfather was a doctor, and he was a homeopath, and among his patients were you know, some really big celebrities. He used to treat people free. He ran a charitable dispensary, and he never took money. He was a chemistry professor who retired early to sort of serve people and, you know, give treat them free. So Dilip Kumar, Nargis, Rakhi Ji, Devanand, Vijay Anand, they were all patients of my grandfather. Oh. And I can very safely say that I've played in their lap. You know, they were always, the clinic we used to run from our house. It was a small cottage in Khar. So yeah, it started, I mean, and so that was an interaction with the film industry when I was very small. Mm-hmm. I mean, I don't have very vivid memories. There are photographs that I have. But not many vivid memories of that time. And then, yeah, I had a normal schooling. I won't say I was a film buff, you know, as I keep saying. I was not this crazy film buff. I was not addicted to films. I was addicted to books. I mean, I used to read a lot. I grew up as a bit of a loner. I liked to be to myself, or, you know, one or two friends. I was very shy. I grew up like very, very shy. And my greatest company was the books.
Books.
Yeah. And there was one time when I had, I would think I was 12 or 13, I had jaundice. and one of our neighbors was, Iftikhar. Iftikhar Ahmed, the legendary police inspector of our 70s and the 80s.
Mm-hmm.
And Dawar from Zanjeer. To whom Amitabh Bachchan says, ke, aaj bhi main phenke hue paise nahi utata. So,
yeah.
He was our neighbor, and he gave me this whole collection of James Rattledge's novels. And there, somewhere, I started getting fascinated, with these stories. I used to sort of visualize these whodunits at that time. And I was really fascinated by James Rattledge's. So I grew up like that, and then my parents, their friends were fascinated with, parallel cinema movement was sort of beginning then. Shyam Benegal, Mohan Yalani. So as I was growing up, particularly the 80s, late 80s, early 80s, I used to go out with my parents to watch films. So that's when I saw, very early days, I saw Saransh, I saw Manthan. So films by Shyam Benegal, then I think I was much older when I saw Arth Satya by Govind Niyalani, I saw Akrod. So I saw a lot of the parallel cinema. I saw Jaane Bhi Do Yaaro in the cinema halls. I wasn't really looking at that career, but I was very focused on my studies. I wanted to get into, a technical field. I wanted to be an engineer. So
it was a personal choice,
you're growing up at a time when, every child around you wants to be either a doctor or an engineer.
Yeah.
Because I was not very happy memorizing biology. So I said, I'm finding it easy to analyze and solve problems. So maybe I should take up maths. And that's why engineering. That was the simplistic logic. And of course, I was to realize later that that was not really my calling at all.
But when did this thought come about wanting to pursue cinema? Did it happen during when you were working as a programmer?
After I studied electronics engineering, but I at a very young age, I had a major affinity towards coding.
Okay.
And I loved programming. Programming even now. When I get a chance, I try to tinker with a little bit of code. I enjoy it. Code is very relaxing, coding. I actually was a programmer, and I was, since I was 14, I was actually programming. So I got into the business of writing programs for people very, very early on, much before engineering happened. And so later on, when I started a small software company, which provided software development services. As part of that company, I sort of went, as part of a business development exercise, I went to Australia and Fiji Islands, develop software for some companies there to develop clients. And I ended up staying there for 3 years. And the company I went to, my first client and then later employer, was in the business of renting out pirated Indian movies.
Okay.
I think it still exists, but it was a chain of video stores around Sydney. Eight stores around Sydney. So my job was to network them. And at that time, networking was very, so I'm talking 1990. It was very basic. The technology was very basic.
Yeah.
There was no internet. So, we were connected through modems and very cumbersome through telephone lines and modems and all. So I finished my work very early. The programming was done. The work was finished early, and then I was on contract, so I had nothing much to do. So then I started sort of spending time in the rental shop, on Saturdays, recommending movies. The Friday and Saturday used to be like jam-packed. It used to be the shops used to be, there would be, there wouldn't be even a moment to breathe. And I turned out to be the resident expert. You know, I'd seen a lot of films. And in my free time in the evenings, I had nothing to do, so I would watch movies. You know, so from the library, I would pick up a movie from the library.
Video.
Watch it. And then make recommendations. So I saw a lot of, like my largest exposure to Indian films was, I think, at that time. And then from there, I moved to Fiji Islands, where I also unwantingly, unknowingly got sort of sucked into a production company.
So okay.
My job was to actually program and to create a graphics module to just, you know, for sports telecasts, to have supers, scores, running scores, statistics, to just create that. But I got more sucked into the production side of it. You know, I started getting fascinated with the cameras, with the editing equipment. And so, and the staff there, there was this sudden, you know, huge number of staff which just left the company. So it was three of us, and it was this big division with equipment which was suddenly going to sink. So I sort of decided, I was 22, I said, I'll bail you out. So I sort of joined there and I sort of jumped in. And I started developing that business, and it did pretty well. I mean, I did ad films there. I did lots of, I shot rugby, I shot football, I shot, you know, marriages, lots of Hindu marriages.
Yeah.
Lots of religious leaders, many, many religious leaders. So, you know, all these places, I realized where, you know, later on you realize that all these places with concentrations of Hindus, you know, the big business of these godmen is to travel there. They come there and they have a series of lectures, and, you know, I mean, the devotees. So it's that the business of God, sort of, I got, you know, the business of cinema and the business of God. I mean, these are the things that I got exposed to there. And I also, you know, had this sudden love for rugby.
Okay.
There was really cricket there. I started sort of following rugby like crazy. I came back to India after 3 years.
Mm-hmm.
It was 93 March is when I flew into Bombay. And I had no savings. I had not saved up any money. Nothing. And with an almost non-existent career in computers, the software business that I had started in India had folded up.
Okay.
I came back with exactly 4,000 rupees, which was a decent amount at that time. Sort of allowed me to survive for almost a month and a half. But so I came back and I didn't know what to do. And ZTV had just, 92 end or something, ZTV had just started. The new satellite TV had just come in.
Yeah.
So that's when, I mean, I said, you know what? So the Gujarati in me sort of woke up. And, you know, I had to look for a business opportunity. So I had two options. One is to find a job and just settle down into a regular, comfy computer infotech job.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
The other was try my hand out at some entrepreneurship. So I made a proposal for a food show. I love food. I made a proposal for a food show, took it to ZTV.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, it was just a chance I took. And within 3 weeks of that proposal, ZTV had given me a check.
Wow.
And and that's what, I mean, the journey began there. I mean, I started Khana Khazana.
With that, sir, we have moved to the second section, assembly line. Since we are already talking about your show, Khana Khazana, could you share with us some learnings you had while working on in television industry that time? And how did you kind of do it without having a formal training in direction?
That is, I mean, I still wonder how. And I think that keeps me also on my feet because, you know, I'm still, every film, there's something new. Something new you want to learn.
Yeah.
You interact with other directors. You learn so much from them. You're learning. I mean, what I learned at that time was that, you know, never stop learning. Never block. I mean, what we do is, you know, because when you call yourself a director, you want to go there pretending you know everything. So I never go on set. I never enter into a film pretending that I know everything. What I like to do is to learn, to absorb. That's what process began there. You know, when we started Khana Khazana, I did not know much about cameras. I had no idea about production. I did not know how I would manage to make the show within the given budget. So, you know, my production instincts sort of got sharpened during Khana Khazana. You know, getting to shoot 4 episodes in a day.
Mm.
So you sort of think on your feet, you plan based on, you know, the minimum available budget.
True.
So those instincts got sharpened while making Khana Khazana, and I must admit I've been lucky. I came in at a time when a lot of great people were also beginning to were searching for themselves, trying to find their feet in the city, in the industry. I also entered at that time, and Khana Khazana, the ZTV started liking me because I stood up for Sanjeev Kapoor. The show became successful, and they took this liking to me, and they had a show called You'll Love Stories.
Okay.
You know, after some 14 episodes, the producers sort of backed out. They offered that to me. They said, you know, would you like to take it over? Because we don't have a producer for it. So I said, yeah, sure, I would like to do that. And then they asked me for stories. I did not have stories. I sat down for 3 days and I typed out some stories that I had in my mind. Because I was such a voracious reader, there were stories that had been around in me. I typed out those stories. I gave them those stories. They liked them. They asked me to make them. And it was as simple as that. They asked me to make them. So the process of, you know, doing narrative storytelling began with that. And I was not intending to initially direct it because I did not know how to. I never directed actors.
Okay.
I never worked with them. I never worked with actors. I had visited the sets of, you know, my cinematographer. He would call me to the set sometimes, you know, when he was shooting fiction or shooting advertising. So I would observe other directors working with actors. So I used to sort of pick up a little bit from there. But, you know, actually going and directing actors is something I learned when I took up my first assignment.
So since you started with nonfiction, would you do nonfiction today also, like in the future? And which subject would you take if you want to do nonfiction?
Food.
Again.
I would do anything. I will donate my films. I will donate the credits, my name. I will donate my national award if I get to do Chef's Table India.
Oh, nice. Is there a plan of, on doing something around IT also? Because you still do coding, some kind of a startup in that zone, that sector. Nothing.
Sort of went out of the window. I play around with my own website. I keep tinkering with the code on that.
Speaking about
very little, I don't get for that. Because a lot of my time is wasted on Twitter fighting with people.
Speaking about your website, I went through this whole blog you have written about your early 3 films, and you talked about those days of uncertainty, and at this time is kind of like that for many many beginners, and that whole piece is so inspiring for us. When you made these films, you had so many back and forths with producers, and you struggled through so many oppositions while making these films. Chal, then Dil Pe Mat Le Yaar, and Jayate didn't even release theatrically. How did you maintain your integrity that time?
I did not maintain my integrity. I completely fucked up. I made my first 3 films, they were there was a certain amount of purity in those films. You know, Jayate, Vipin Mathiya, Chal, each of them, you know, they were trying to do something. They were trying to tell a story. They were trying to explore characters. So they began, I mean, those films were an extension of my some of my early television work, you know, where I had experimented with form. You know, as I was telling you, all the friends that I had made in the television, you know, Vishal Bhardwaj, Anurag Kashyap, Manoj Bajpayee, you know, Ashish Vidyarthi, a lot of really, really good friends that I made, and Saurabh Shukla then, later, Saurabh Shukla. So I got a lot from them, you know, so together we sort of tried to create stuff, you know, so with whether it was Jayate, which was Anurag's, technically Anurag's first film as a writer, his first feature.
Yes, yes.
So Jayate, you know, was with Anurag, then Dilpe Matliar, Vishal composed the music, you know. So, I mean, the even in television, Vishal did all my music in television. So, yeah, I mean, so, you know, I mean, the sum total of, you know, your career is, you know, all these connections that you make and, you know, how all of you work together.
True,
so,
true.
After that, I think somewhere I lost, because those films, you know, Jayate did not get released. Dilpe Matliar, I was trying to say something in that film, you know, trying to tell the story of migrants. It got mired into a silly and very, very unfortunate political incident.
You mentioned in your blog that you one day want to remake Chal in the right way and bring out the right spirit of the film.
That was something I felt, you know, now I don't. No, I honestly don't.
Okay.
In the film. The film per se had nothing to say. It was a stylish film. It was very, very stylish for that time. It was very cool. The music was fantastic. And two really fantastic actors taking it. Prashant Narayanan. It began the career of Supan Verma, who was writing. It was a Rediff.com critic there. So he left his job because of that film. But that was the last of the films that had some sort of honesty, integrity in it.
Mm-hmm.
And then I made a whole string. I think I made around five really indifferent films. I didn't make them with any indifference, but they were made for the wrong reasons. And the wrong reasons were mine. I made them for the wrong reasons, and the films did not turn out well. They were quite pathetic. The films were, some of them were really, really bad. So, yeah, I mean, I went through that phase between 2002 and 2008. So 6 years where I was directing continuously. I did lots of television again.
Mm-hmm.
I made films. But nothing really worked. Nothing worked. I was sort of digging a deeper hole for myself creatively. Creatively, I was almost, I mean, dead. I was comatose at that time. I could not even think up stories. I mean, the only story I found at that time, somewhere in 2006, 2005, 2006, when my friend Mukul Dev,
yes,
the drinking buddy, so he sort of just gave me this idea that there was this character called Omar Sheikh, who was, you know, part of the Kandahar hijack.
Mm-hmm.
So I sort of it sparked off an idea, and I decided to explore it and to write it, but nobody wanted to make that film. I explored that idea for the longest time, wrote a script, but pitched it to a number of producers. But nobody really wanted to make it for two reasons. One, they felt that the subject was too, you know, too provocative. And B, because they thought I was not capable of making it.
Okay.
The kind of work I had done, you know, the work was, some of it was really, really bad. So yeah, I was not even looking for redemption at that time. Till, I mean, 2008, March 31, 2008, when I sort of stopped you know, I Woodstock Villa is a film that released on that day, and May 31, 2008. I mean, that was the day I took off. I left the city, took off for the village, and decided I was not going to make films unless there was a compelling reason to do so. So yeah, that was again a gap of 3 years. I did not make any films, and I sort of tried to sort of rediscover, re-energize, reinvent myself. It was fruitful but a very painful 3 years.
Okay. Since you said that you were not creatively satisfied that time, between that period 2002 to 2008, today
I see this. I was dead. I was comatose. I was not. You see, what happens is very often you are aware. There's an awareness that you are not creatively satisfied. And the other is this lack of awareness. And I was suffering from a lack of awareness. You know, I was not even aware that I was creatively dead. So I was suffering from an acute lack of awareness. And, you know, who knows? I mean, I'm not sure. I was perhaps, you know, going through some sort of depression, you know, clinical depression at that time, you know, mentally.
You think about that right now, like you think it might have happened. And that time we were not aware about the whole thing.
I'm not aware of it. I did not recognize it. But yes, I was going through mental, you know, definitely there was some mental health issue, which sort of, you know, just made me completely, you know, I was bottled up. I was suffocated and going further and further into this deep, endless pit. You know, I just kept going in. It was, life was spiraling downwards and out of control. So, I mean, you know, that now that I look back and I see my state of mind and my heavy dependence on alcohol at that time, I realized that, you know, there was a mental health issue.
Have you discussed it with someone about those days and tried to figure out what it was really?
With my wife, you know, so I sort of went through a similar phase recently after I made Simran.
Yes, because of the controversies that happened, because of that?
The controversies, I mean, the whole process was not very pleasant. It was not a great. The process of making that film was quite unpleasant and extremely, extremely dissatisfying. And, you know, through the process only, I mean, I started finding myself slipping into some sort of a, you know, mental health issue. I realized that I had slipped into depression. I was deep into depression. By the time the film, I mean, almost a year and a half into the film, after the film had released also, I was going through a very, very dark, I mean, I used to always, I mean, imagine dark things happening to me. So it was a very deep, but at that time, I mean, I sought some sort of help. I spoke, you know, I had people I could talk to, and I sort of found myself way out of it, you know, I found a way out of it early enough without having to rely on medication. So it wasn't a very clear, I think it was not clinical, it was more of a psychological issue at that time, you know, something, it was a post-traumatic stress disorder that I had imposed on myself. And so, I mean, that phase luckily passed, and I was also busy. I made Omerta.
Yes.
Very satisfying. So, you know, the availability of satisfying work sort of helped me overcome, you know, that depression very quickly.
On that note, let's move on to the third section called Harvest, and let's talk about the films that you made in your second innings from Shahid onwards. But you have said this, that the second inning started when you found the right people to collaborate with, and the right people brought the best out of you. How does one, a beginner, find the right people? So many people are struggling in this city to find the right space, right environment. Is this just a matter of time and patience and luck, or can there be a certain kind of a calculated effort that someone can make?
I don't think it's a calculated effort. These friendships, you know, whether it's Anubhav, Sinha, Anurag, Vishal, Tigmanshu, and so many people that I sort of began my career with.
Yeah.
I think we nurtured those friendships. We've had our ups and downs, but we nurtured them, you know, at a time when most of us did not have that much of work, did not have much money. Mm-hmm. But we spent that time together, knowing that, you know, there was something. The road ahead was not dark. We knew that somewhere deep. Mm-hmm. Nurtured each other's talent. We shared knowledge, and I think all of us, you know, and so that kind of friendship is continued. So I mean, when I came back also to Bombay for Shahid, you know, yes. One of the first persons I reached out to was the producer of the film, Sunil yes. Bora, old friend, and to Anurag.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I reached out to Anurag. I said, Anurag, I need your help. Anurag by then had made Devi, Gulal, and he was, you know, writing this. He had also just started Anurag Kashyap Films. He was producing yes. a lot of films at that time. So I asked for Anurag's help. I said, you know, Sunil wants to make this film, but if my film has your name attached to it, it will help me. So Anurag said that, you know, I think this time you will make a good film. So you come back with a vengeance. You want to desperate. So, you know, he gave me. So the thing about, you know, having these kinds of friendships is that you energize each other. You give each other the energy to make work. You know, this kind of work that all of us are doing does not come from this selfish echo chamber. It comes from a collective awareness and a very collaborative friendship where we show each other our work, we read yeah. each other scripts, and I think that began. I mean, during Shahid, of course, yeah, Anurag really supported me that entire phase where the film had gotten completed and nothing was happening to the film. Again, I was in despair. I said, you know, once again, I've made a film. Some people have watched it. They've said it's good, but nothing's happening. And then, you know, the film got selected at the Toronto Film Festival at TIFF 2012. And that sort of opened the doors. The floodgates had, you know, had sort of opened up, that the film had this international exposure. People saw me as a filmmaker again. And the story resonated so strongly, and it continues to resonate. I mean, so Shahid and in the process of that, Rajkumar Rao,
yeah,
who was Rajkumar Yadav, I mean, these two things all changed my life. And you know, it was this wonderful call to meet Rajkumar in the first place, and then to decide that yes, this is my Shahid. And so, you know, having Rajkumar as Shahid is perhaps the single best decision I have taken in my entire life.
Very true, very true. And how beautifully that collaboration has grown over the years, and it's one of the best actor-director collaboration in the past decade of Indian cinema. And let's talk more about this. Like, how has the personal relationship grown over the years? And you often say that Rajkumar is like my wife in films. He has those qualities which I look for in my wife. What are these qualities, and how does it?
I don't know. I mean, Rajkumar, the relationship that we share has gone beyond this, that we have to meet every day. He has to call me and be polite with me. We talk when we feel the need to. When you're on set, I mean, it's as if we've been together all the time. you know. So there's this understanding which I am unable to describe. I know when we are on the set, mm-hmm. From my face that, you know, I want another take. I know looking at him that he's not happy with what he has done.
Okay.
He wants one more take. There are times when I want to tell him something, I don't need to. He says, okay, I know what you want.
Mm-hmm.
So it's that kind of a collaboration. I mean, you know, and yes, we've also chosen those stories, those characters, you know, our collaboration also thrives on challenging each other. So there's a new challenge every time.
Mm-hmm.
It was Aligarh, the challenge was, yes, there was this powerful central character of Dr. Siras. And there was this Malayali lawyer called Deepu. And that Deepu's character sort of shone in the film. So somehow, you know, finding, you know, we thrive on those challenges. Whether it is Aligarh, City Lights, you know, being that Rajasthani band, you know, it was a remake. City Lights was
Metro Manila.
Metro Manila, a film I have still not seen.
Okay.
I've not seen. I bought the Blu-ray after City Lights released. I found it in London, and then the Blu-ray was the wrong region.
Mm-hmm.
I could never watch it. But it was a remake. So what we did to the film is because the reason I didn't watch it is I wanted to interpret the written, adapted. So you know that whole Rajasthani man, that body language. So that I mean that was perhaps one of our very one of our tightest collaborations, that character, the character of Deepak in that film. And of course, after that, it was Omerta. Omerta was something that we really, really, I mean, we had a great time doing it, but it was also a difficult, dark. So again, you know, you every time you challenge each other, you say, you know, what about this?
Mm-hmm.
So I give him those characters I think he interprets them like nobody else would. It's a relationship that is very precious. The working relationship, the professional relationship is very, very precious, because what we create is something that, you know, I always take a lot of pride in.
Since you spoke that, said that the camera was like an observer in Shahid, how do you approach that kind of cinema and still keep it engaging by showing just real life? Because real life can be very boring too. And like, how do you maintain that balance of not just shooting, taking a camera and shooting real life, but showing a representation of real life on cinema, but still keep it real? How do you find that?
So I think, I don't know. It's difficult. You're asking me this question. I'm trying to articulate it.
Okay.
Are ultimately what you are presenting on screen is an illusion.
Mm-hmm.
And I've grown watching Indian cinema, Hindi films. So our storytelling has sort of been ingrained, whether it is Yash Chopra or it is Shyam Benegal. There's a certain storytelling style that has been ingrained, Mahesh Bhatt. It's been ingrained in me. So what I try to do is that I use, like Shahid follows a very conventional plot-based narrative. And I have just tried to present it. It's the way the film is overall packaged. You see, like the courtroom scenes in Shahid.
Yes, exactly.
They were written exactly like any normal courtroom scene where, you know, one guy says something, the other guy stands up, says objection. Judge says order.
Yeah.
Then one argument, louder argument. You know, it's that the graph of any regular courtroom scene. Maybe it's a better courtroom scene than what you've seen in the past. You know, a John Grisham kind of courtroom scene. It was written that way. What we did is we went and observed the courts.
Yeah.
Both spent a lot of time in court. We took Vipin Sharma, who played the prosecution lawyer.
Yeah.
We also to court. So we observed the courts. And we took that same story and we gave it a new interpretation. We took that those scenes and interpreted them differently. We so we heard a lot of overlapping chaos.
Yeah.
So the same graph. I said, don't break the graph of the scene. The graph is the same. You know, from injustice, slowly there's hope, there's falling hope, and then there's this uplifting summation, and Shahid wins the case. It follows a very regular graph.
True. But
that
true.
Graph is now presented to the chaos of the Indian judicial system. And so the lens is the chaos in the judicial system. So the moment you create that chaos, so your scenes start feeling very real.
Am I on trial?
You're not on
trial. On trial? Who's on trial?
I'm just stating certain facts.
Am I on trial? Fahim Khan is on trial.
And there's another fact.
Speaking of your other film, Omerta, when you make a film on such a flawed character, what kind of a state of mind do you maintain during the shoot that allows you to just present the story of this character without glorifying or even judging this character? Because in real life, we might have certain opinions about this character, but on film, we just need to show the story.
I try to, you know, as a director, your state of mind, it's important that, you know, all my films, I have never judged their principal characters. They have presented the story as you see it. So Shahid also, in his own way, in his family, was a flawed boy. You know, he...
Yes, that's true. That's true too.
He had his own flaws. So I let those flaws be. And my job, as an observer, is to observe that character as he is. So for me, filmmaking is about, making a film is about character for me, much before it is about story. For me, the character is paramount. So, all my films are an exploration of a character. Even Simran is trying to explore this flawed girl. So the idea is to always explore your characters by observing them, and to, along with me, I become what the audience will ultimately become while I'm shooting,
True.
The lensing is that, the way the scenes are shot, the way it is interpreted is the way I would like to see that particular moment or that character unfold before me, with my eyes. So, I don't know how more clearly I can explain that to you. It is it's part of my directorial style.
Yes.
I don't touch my character. I never ever tell somebody, this is, you're playing a horrible guy. You're playing a guy, a normal guy, who is doing these things.
Hmm.
He's driven by this ideology, however flawed it might be, by this ideology to do these things, which the world perceives as horrible. So the moment you take that distance from the story, you interpret. And then you have when you have Rajkumar, I can't describe that enough. Having an actor like him, who actually, for him it was a tough one because he had to be in that state of mind.
Yes.
And that state of mind was tough on him. It was tough on me also because his state of mind sort of would sometimes get to me. It used to irritate me at times.
Yeah, you spoke about that tennis game where he used to be very aggressive.
Yes. So he developed this, he was quiet, aggressive. But ultimately, when making films, I know one thing, we have fun while making films. Okay? The most important thing is I'm making films and I will continue making films till I enjoy making them. And I love making them. I enjoy being on set, enjoy shooting. The biggest takeaway from the process of filmmaking is the process itself. It's not the awards. It's not the film's box office success. It is not the film's critical acclaim. It is the process that remains with you as this treasure trove of, you know, that process is what makes you grow as a human being. That process is what makes you grow as a filmmaker. It is not, it's not acclaim, it is not criticism, it is not box office success, it is not awards. What you learn from the process of exploration, of exploring those characters, of telling the story, and being with these phenomenal people who are making the film, that makes you a complete filmmaker. For me, that's what filmmaking means to me.
Speaking of Shahid and Omurta together, Omar takes the path. They both come from the same roots, but they go towards different directions. Shahid picks up the path of righteousness. Omar takes up the challenge of taking the law into his hands and getting his own justice by ways which are not recommended. Shahid gets killed, but Omar still lives on. And you have said this in an interview that terrorism is an activity by the establishment to maintain a status quo. And recently there was a Facebook video which was very viral, which was from a school in Pakistan, where the kids were being asked what they want to be when they grow up. One of the kids came and said that I want to become an army officer and save Pakistan and destroy India. And I'm sure these kind of feelings are put in many such common people in both the countries. And how do we make the people understand that this feeling of hatred which has grown in them over the years for these countries is not something which comes from within them organically, but it's an induced thing which is an output of a greater politics of the establishment and the counter-establishment? Or is this something instinctive, because is this the core of human existence and civilization, that there is a concept of good, there is a concept of evil, and you are either participating or observing, but this is how it will be? How do you look at this thing?
This is how it will be is a very cynical worldview. I am one of those who believe that, you know, there is power. Stories have the power to transform. Stories have the power to inform. Stories have the power to provoke. Stories have the power to inspire. So I think as a storyteller, our job is to keep telling those stories and not to be afraid. So, you know, many people ask me, why the hell do you want to make a film about such a horrible guy? So then why did I want to make Shahid? Because, you know, I needed this companion piece to understand. You see, the bigger problem is that a lack of understanding of the world that we live in. Our understanding is driven by WhatsApp. Our understanding is driven by social media influencers. Our understanding is not driven by our own values, by our own, because we don't let them develop enough. And I think as storytellers, we have a responsibility to imbibe those values, somehow to help you articulate your own values, your empathy, your lack of sympathy, your hatred, your love, everything. I mean, you sort of, as a storyteller, help people introspect. And I think that's what I'm trying to do, you know, to help people introspect by telling different stories. By not being afraid to tell Omar's story, but I tell those stories in a way that, I could have told Omar's story differently. I was criticized for it. And, you know, you didn't tell us what is compulsion. I said, no, I don't. I don't believe. I believe that his compulsions are still, not worth, because it's not enough. Those compulsions are in his head. It's something psychological. It is not that he was racially profiled as a kid, that he was harassed. I mean, those are small events. They are symptoms. Mm-hmm. The larger illness, which is here, which is within us. And, you know, as a storyteller, I'm trying to address what is within you, not just, you know, those symptoms that, oh, this guy, isne ladki ko cheda, to maine usko maar diya.
Hmm.
Yeah. You know, it's not as simple as that. That, you know, Pakistan breeds terrorists. It's not as simple as that. I mean, that's what the WhatsApp University has created, these one-dimensional stereotypes, even in the stories that we tell. You know, they've created this view, you know, that the simplest solution, no matter how wrong it is the right solution. So, you know, you find Riya Chakrabarty responsible for Sushant's so-called murder, you know, and so it's these simple solutions. So it, you're trying not to tax people's minds into thinking. You know, and that's where I'm coming back to the beginning of a conversation, that we are living in this dystopian 1984,
yeah,
where we are trying to numb people from really exploring, you know, their own thinking. You know, the thought police, the social media is the thought police. It is trying to limit people's thinking. It is trying to limit their political beliefs. It is trying to limit humanity from progressing. And I think as storytellers, we have to stop that. We have to stem the flow of this rot.
Thank you so much, Hansal sir, for giving us so much time. It was lovely talking to you. Thank you for sharing your insights about your life and work. And may you continue to tell us extraordinary stories of ordinary people as you have been doing all these years. Thank you so much. All the best for all your releases, Scam 92 and Chalang. And stay safe, sir.
Thank you. It was you too. Stay safe.
Hey guys, if you like that video, do share it with your friends and family. Do not forget to subscribe to the Red Sparrow for educative and entertaining content, and make sure you press the bell icon.